Good afternoon, sir. First of all, thank you for being a part of our second edition of Faculty Talk Show. I would like to take this opportunity to first introduce Professor Soumya Chaudhary to our audience who will be viewing this video later on. Professor Chaudhary did his graduation from IIT Bombay in Electrical and Communication. Further, sir completed his post-graduation in management with a specialization in finance from IIM Ahmedabad. Sir has a lot of experience when he brings to the table. He has in the past worked in IBM, DSP Merrill Lynch, KPMG, and also apart from being an adjunct faculty at JAXOM, he is also a co-founder in a visible logistics and a supply chain startup called VisiLogix. Thank you, sir. We were actually looking forward to have this session with you. You are a great presence in the campus. It is wonderful to interact with you. So before we start with our questions, sir, is there anything that you would like to kickstart the session with, any thoughts?
So I think, you know, really, I find JAXOM is a place which is, you know, there's a very close interaction between students and faculty, and, you know, you don't have a lot of formalities. So since we are trying to turn out students who are going to be professionals, and we are a professional school, we think that interaction with people who are not only professors but also come from the industry probably prepares the students more about what to expect from industry. So I think that's a strength. The second, I think, is that you know, just the fact that you have management who are entrepreneurs themselves, I think creates a very different orientation to students, where you are supposed to learn different subjects from a perspective of applicability. So I think that is where probably this campus is, or curriculum is, different from most traditional MBAs, and I come from a very traditional MBA. So I really know, you know, how a typical IIM, let's say, operates versus you know, campus like this. And I'm really pleased to see that, you know, there are lot of positives. And of course, there are a lot of negatives as well. The negatives, I think, are really around very long study hours. Of course, I'll become very unpopular with my fellow professors for stating that. But I think there is a lot of requirement for people to do deep, research. I mean, you may not call it research, but, you know, some deep understanding of a subject which they are interested in, where they have time to do that. But if you get stuck in trying to, you know, do 1 hour 15 minutes of, you know, 10 different subjects, maybe that's not the best use of time, according to me. And this is what the IIMs, I think, do, that they give, you know, pretty much the second half of, so that the students can, of course, prepare for class the next day. And that's, I think, one thing that probably I find a lot of students come unprepared to class. Yeah. And so maybe that free time could be used for this. And the other is also interactions itself, because I think, you know, when you're interacting in a professional environment like an MBA school, it's almost like you are getting into a job in a peer situation. So how do you stand out? How do you become a leader without the authority? You know, kind of, so it's that kind of, you know, dynamics which I think a campus like this plays out. And the other thing is, since it's relatively small, there is far more interaction between students than, you know, if people were dispersed in, you know, hostels, all, you know, across a, you know, I don't know, 10 acre campus. So of course, I think what I really like about the campus is that most of the professors come from industry, and they are professionals in their own way. They're still also very open to honest feedback and criticism, which I think very few places are. And there's a very close interaction between students and faculty. So those are the three strengths I would carry away from this place.
That's certainly so. Being faculties from industry, it feels like we are actually interacting with the future bosses. So that gives, you know, a deep insight. Like, they actually advise us that, okay, when you go out, you have to do this, you have to take care of that. So that is one thing that actually is a thing that we all students also look forward to.
Huge benefit for us.
Right.
And plus, like you said, that just giving a 1 hour 15 minutes of study won't help. Scratching a surface in our line of business won't work. We have to have in-depth study for that.
Yeah.
That is very much required as of now.
So there is a course like RI, which actually gives you that exposure, right? Research initiative. But how serious are people in doing that, right? So it's an opportunity to do research. But then a lot of people feel that, you know, is this something that is required in an MBA program or it should be part of a PhD program? But I think the way to look at it is that, okay, this is my chance to get deeper. Like Google gives something where 20% or Friday is given off to do your personal project. Now that personal project has to align with the company's objective. It can't be something completely different. But then it realizes that people are passionate about something, which let's say aligns. So can we actually leverage that time to give them the chance to create depth? Rather than, let's say, having a picnic on Friday, you know, which is like, you know, they're giving you time off, but, you know, that is not useful from a company's standpoint, and also getting depth. So I have a very high, or used to have a very high respect for Google before all these data privacy issues came up, because I thought that it has that common thing that it treats individuals like, you know, each one as a unique star performer.
Stop.
Rather than, you know, someone who's just, you know, got good grades or comes from a, you know, let's say a better ranked university. So Google doesn't have that. And the other thing is that they actually, treat people with their strengths and try and get deeper on that. But the flip side, and that is true for all IT or tech companies, is that since the numbers are so large, the chance to actually make progress in terms of going up the hierarchy is reduced because, you know, it's a pyramid, right? So that is where I think a lot of people leave and, you know, probably like me do startups or something. But I think sometimes that startup idea is not driven by something which is coming from inside but maybe because of lack of progression within a large organization. So I think one of the things I've learned in a place like IBM, because IBM has around around 300,000 employees, of which around 100,000 are in India, and I was in India, that, you know, the chance of progression was restricted. But if you felt that you were personally adding value every day to yourself, it was actually something that, you know, you could continue for years. And if I look at my colleagues in IBM, I was there for 10 years. It's probably the longest stint I've had in a corporate, because I've been in 7 or 8 jobs in my professional career of around 22 years before I started up. So it's definitely been my longest stint. I know people who have been there for 20 plus years. And if you go to IBM ASEAN, people have been there 25 plus years. So why is that? They have the same challenges. But the issue is they have decided that, okay, you know, the person to improve is themselves. And there's enough resources available. So how do I marry both of that? So I think that is one of the lessons that I think, you know, we would want the students to take away, that it's not fancy designations that make you. You might actually have someone who's probably, you know, done very well in progressing the hierarchy, but who might internally be a wreck. Because, you know, there's loneliness, right? As you rise to the top, there's loneliness, and, you know, your friends become, you become their bosses,
Frenemies.
And they obviously... So it could be that even at a middle management level, you are actually happy with what you're doing because you think you are making a difference. And when I look at, let's say, my professional life, I can think of, you know, places like DSP Merrill Lynch and and Sona Steering, where I was actually automotive industry. You probably skipped that because it didn't sound as fancy a name as Merrill Lynch. But I could tell you that these two companies were probably the best years of my professional life, and for very different reasons. Merrill Lynch was cutting edge. It was the number one investment bank. I got a chance to join it after 1 year from campus. It was my second job, not my first job. I landed up getting into a role which the person who was the highest ranked guy from my college got into a different department called corporate finance, and I got M&A, mergers and acquisitions, which was the top department in Merrill. And this guy didn't talk to me for a year because he said, you know, how is this guy who's middle of the batch getting a role which is better than what he is, and he was sixth ranker of the batch, right? So don't always believe that your first job makes or defines you. And in that company, there was cutting edge people. Everyone was, you know, really, I would say, very, very professional and very, they knew their job very well. So that was a reason I had a lot of satisfaction, and I took investment banking as a great career that I really wanted to prolong. Of course, I made a couple of missteps on the way, which I'll talk about later. But, and the second job to me was Sona Koyo Steering, which is an auto company. And it was like, you know, I don't think any person from, you know, the top institutions would want to join a company like that. And I was an automotive investment banker. So I mean, auto was one of the sectors I covered. And I joined that because they, I mean, I knew they were part of my coverage list. And I wanted to get into operations and get my hands dirty, not operations as in production, but, you know, get into a business role instead of being a consulting role or a financial services role. So I joined that and I got huge autonomy because I was reporting to the chairman directly. I didn't have any layers between me and, you know, let's say the MD or CFO. Yeah. I didn't have any reporting through them. So I was reporting directly to the promoter, Dr. Surinder Kapoor. And he gave me a chance to run a business which was a auto parts, you know, it was a supply chain business. So I was an entrepreneur. And what I found was that when I'm left to myself, I'm able to perform well. So whether it was M&A, where I was the youngest of a four-member team and I was like, you know, all the time in office, or it was even on my anniversary, my wife had to come to office and drag me out because, you know, we were like practically, you know, the standard, you know, investment banking jobs. And Sona, because it gave me a lot of autonomy, once your trust was established, that means you're thinking first about the company and then about yourself. Right, because that I think all companies want to assess that, you know, whether. So there, when I started the supply chain business as an entrepreneur, and again, you know, I became a business head and all that stuff, and I was around 35 years old. So it gave me a, you know, real exposure to how to be a like a mini CEO in an organization, and I thought that kind of exposure I would have not got in a big company, because it would take me, I would not become CEO before 55 or 60. Oh, yes. So that was one. And you know, how to be a proud Indian, right? Because see, I think all of us ultimately want to do good for the country. And we are inherently proud, but you know, somehow that gets stifled because of, you know, infrastructure bottlenecks or various things we see, you know, people talk badly about India. But you know, to be a proud Indian company, that itself was, and with someone who was a promoter who was not a Lala. He was a PhD from Michigan State University, right? Dr. Surinder Kapoor. And his son was very different. His son was second generation, spoiled, whatever, right? So it was very different. But since I was reporting to the first generation entrepreneur who was a PhD, that gave me a lot of ideas of what I really wanted to do. So when I was in my IBM days, I obviously thought a lot about quitting and all that, but then the startup idea really spawned from, you know, what I did in Sona Koyo. So what I think is that MBA should not restrict their options to only the very standard kind of jobs. Because for instance, if I had not moved out from Merrill, I would have probably, you know, left Merrill when I was 55 or 60 years old, like almost like at retirement, right? So I would have had no exposure to any other sector. And all I would be doing is earning more money year on year, probably having a Merc, probably having, you know, two, three apartments. But, you know, that is not my idea of success. My idea of success is that, you know, can you leverage all your learning, whether it is engineering, whether it's your MBA, whether it's things I learned in KPMG in tax and, you know, there were things on due diligence from an accounting standpoint. So those things we typically look down on when we say we are MBAs because, you know, we are basically only dealing in strategy and, you know, all these tax and audit and all these issues are below us, right? But actually, that is the crux of how to be someone who knows a lot about business. Because if you use every learning opportunity in the job you have to be able to pick up some new skills and you consciously try and increase your knowledge, you'll find that at some point of time, whether you're a startup founder or you are in another role in another job, that knowledge is helping you tremendously and helping you stand out vis-a-vis other people who are relatively, you know, who are satisfied being a specialist in one area. So let me leave it at that, because, you know, MBAs typically are taken as people who are shallow. So to cut that image, you have to basically be someone who's showcasing, yes, you're a generalist, but you also have deep knowledge in different areas, whether it is, you know, strategy itself, or it's around finance, or it's on, you know, some of these other aspects which are, I would say, the core of finance, you know, or financial controls. In Sona Koyo, I was this at the same level as the CFO, right? So the CFO was a typical chartered accountant who knew everything about audit and controls, and I was the head of corporate finance, who was like basically M&A, fundraising, investor relations, you know, and all interaction with all these private equity kind of thing. But I learned a lot from the financial controls guys, because I didn't come from a BCom or a, you know, CA kind of background. Yeah. But what I'm saying is that everything is an opportunity to learn, and as a result of that thing, I was able to manage my entrepreneurship well, because I was the only finance guy in that organization of four people. All the other three or four people were engineers who were supply quality assurance engineers. They knew nothing about finance. So I actually, because I was interacting with, you know, this gentleman who was the CFO and who was, you know, also in some way helping me around those controls, I was in touch with the purchasing department. They were telling me how, you know, to shortlist vendors and, you know, get that, because that became the core part of the function. So I went as an M&A guy, and I landed up being a sort of, you know, okay, you can say entrepreneur, but the core role was purchasing, because you are the India sourcing office of European OEMs, I mean, tier one suppliers, and you are learning mechanical engineering, which I mean, I'm not even a core mechanical engineer, I'm an electrical engineer, right? So, so there was a lot of those kind of things that I'm very grateful for. But if you look at it from outside, everyone will say, okay, you know, this is a chap who probably, you know, went around a lot of dabbling with a lot of areas, but, you know, really didn't find his calling. But if I look at it from my point of view, I thought, you know, life gave me a lot of opportunities to do very different jobs, and where, you know, the rise was not only because someone paid you 20% higher for doing exactly the same job. And I think that's one of the things that MBA is actually something that I highly recommend to everyone. In fact, if possible, my two sons will also probably enroll for MBA program, you know, God willing. Because that gives you opportunity to get any kind of job. So I moved from being a management consultant to a investment banker in M&A, to an investment banker in corporate finance, which is ADR, GDR kind of issues. Okay, so that, to a mid-sized M&A guy for, you know, and there I covered different sectors. So from auto, I moved to telecom and cement. And then apart from auto, which I also had to look after, and then to a operating company where I was first the M&A guy, and investor relations was a new function that time for me, you know, interacting with analysts and, you know, basically propelling our stock price, to running a business, to then moving to IBM as the M&A sort of person, functional guy, to being in a sales function, hardcore sales as a finance guy. I mean, which profession or qualification will give you that chance? So I think that is something that I very strongly stand up for MBAs. But I think where we go wrong is that we presume we know everything at the end of the course. So that continuous learning journey stops somewhere. And that is something that I would implore your batch to, you know, continuously be on this learning mode.
That's a wonderful take on MBAs. Like, I think that's a pretty unique perspective. Like, generally,
crystal clear perspective on what we as MBAs should always look.
Connecting your personal experience to ours. So, sir, moving on from this, this one question that we have to ask you, that analytics is something that is kind of constantly being inculcated in each and every domain.
Yeah.
So, as of now, analytics is generally used for revenue enhancement or customer acquisition. So many companies are actually shifting towards using big data, machine, and these type of stuff for these purposes. But do you think that still some players in the industry are still resisting the change to accept the fact that, yeah, we have to use this to, you know, for a way forward for the future?
So as you know, in traditional management terms, you know, Peter Drucker and those kind of things. There was a lot of, I would say, focus on management by gut feel. And that moved to management by using data. So I think it's really a mix of both, right? So now, of course, there is a lot of ways in which we get the data to indicate what we want to do fundamentally. So it's like gut feel hidden through statistics. So I always have this kind of suspicion on very good results, right? So if statistics is throwing up some very clear directions, I immediately start suspecting that, you know, is this something which has been probably tailored towards a decision you wanted to make, but you wanted data to prove it, right? But I think today nobody can ignore analytics. And business analytics, from being reporting dashboards, you know, quarterly kind of numbers, which has been happening for last, you know, 20, 30 years, is moving to big data because organizations realize that they have a lot of structured and unstructured data, and how do they use that? I wouldn't say that people have still figured out how to use all their unstructured data. But no organization can say we are not analytics driven, because immediately their stock price will fall by 50% if they say that. So I think there's a lot of, I would say, positioning or way in which people are trying to project themselves as more advanced from an analytics standpoint than they really are. But it is all evolution. Like IBM has a scale of, I think, 5, you know, so you start with something where you're, you know, absolute basic in data analytics to, you know, the most advanced levels, and they call it, you know, different names. So I don't want to get into that, but it's like basically saying that it's a journey, and that takes around 10 years, right? So it's not something that happens over 2 years or 6 months. So that 10-year journey, you have to be persistent, and you have to have your senior management also see the benefit of that, because there's a lot of investments of time and your best employees to be able to drive this journey. It cannot be done by consultants and outside people. Maybe they can provide some overall direction, but it has to be driven internally, right? So that journey has to be persistent, and even if, you know, it's not making progress over, you know, 6 months or a year, you should not lose faith and say, okay, let's go back to how we worked before. So I would say no organization can ignore it, but where they are on their journey is different. Things are moving from data analytics to data science or big data. Now, these are all terminologies, I would still say, because big data is now called data science. But essentially, where you are using all the data you have, so unstructured as well as structured, to be able to kind of make better decisions is the journey. So I would say everyone is on that path, but where they are is probably where an industry maturity study can be done and to figure out. But I think one thing that we pay a lot of emphasis to models, right? So there's a lot of issue around deep learning and, you know, LSTM, RNN, CNN, whatever, right? All the kind of terminologies, reinforcement learning itself. But the model is only as good as the data. And on the other hand, you talk to people who are from the data side, they will say, okay, first show me the data, then we will see whether, you know, there's any merit in moving forward at all. Again, I would say it's a mix of both, right? You can't just be someone who's saying, okay, show me the data and then I'll do something, or someone who's just kind of giving you, you know, very high-end, you know, sophisticated terminology to show how advanced the organization is, but the data layer is not at the level that the data lake is all linked together, has structured data, there is cleansing that has happened. It's data which is ready to be ingested into a model to get reasonable results. So that's called ETL, right? Extract, transform, load. So you have to be able to get that journey going from both sides. So the data engineers as well as the data modelers. So if you see a typical data science kind of thing, they say there are 5 kind of roles, right? So, I mean, everyone is not called a data analyst or a data scientist or a data modeler. There could be data engineers who are really bothered about how good the data is, how to ingest, from what sources, how to get data, to actually add value. And then you have statisticians, you have data scientists, data modelers, model creators. And, you know, you probably have people who are even interpreting results, right? So even that's an important thing, because otherwise to a business person, a lot of this output from models need to make sense. So all kind of people get together and create this organization, which is definitely here to stay.
Sir, actually we have a very diverse MBA batch this time.
Yeah.
So they have a little feelings that being in the finance or especially in the fintech, yeah, they need certain programming skills.
Yeah.
So how important that programming skills is and what are the skill set which are required for both technological person, those who are from engineering background, and the other non-engineering background to gain so that they can future-proof their job?
So I would, put it in another way, right? So if you look at people who are today head of data science in any, let's say, best-in-class organization today, I'm just giving some names, right? Mu Sigma, Fractal, NASSCOM, etc., etc. Some of them are our ex-students, right? And you ask them what is their background, right? You'll be very surprised. They are not engineers. And they have spent 18 years in data science. Data science. I'm not talking of business analytics, right? So it runs. See, human mind is so powerful that if you're interested in doing something, you will do it. And if you're not interested in something, however intelligent you are, it will not get done. Okay, that's my learning in life. So what I would just say is that if you're able to overcome, and this I tell in class as well, that if you're a BBA, BCom, BA, etc., as long as you don't have a fear of programming, not math. Math you may have, because no one is doing linear algebra kind of thing when you're doing programming, right? You're doing programming based on a logic. As long as you don't have fear of programming, you can actually do fantastically well. And I think there have been some talks by people who are our ex-students who are now head of AI, ML and NASSCOM, Snehanshu, Mitra, and other people. They all come from BCom backgrounds. They're all BComs. Sameer Dhanranjani, who was the head of strategy for Mu Sigma and then one other company. He's runs a data science business. He's a CEO, right? He was a adjunct professor here. He teaches digital innovation and introduction to digital business as well. So Sameer, they're all BComs. And on the other hand, if you look at engineers, a lot of the engineers are escaping from engineering to do their MBA. Okay, so let's say they didn't like engineering.
Yeah.
And they want to do MBA and do something completely different. So don't presume that these engineers who are in that mode, of course, they're engineers who are, who want to go back and join technology. Mm. And, but those, I would say, are minority. And the other thing is that most of the engineers don't come from computer science background. So it's not that they have got a huge exposure to programming. Maybe, first 1 or 2 years, they would have had some common courses in computer science. Introduction to Programming 101. That's it. So there is not really too much to differentiate between an engineer and a non-engineer of this mode. So I would say, Sant, don't look at, and this is something that probably you need to, evangelize, that there's nothing like engineer and non-engineer, according to me. And on the other hand, in my batch, there were a lot of people from economics background who came from Lady Sriram, LSR, various economics, North Campus, Delhi University, etc. They got beaten by the IIT guys who had not done economics except one course. Let's say it was one elective in this one IIT Madras guy, who beat these students in economics in term one or term two, I think, because economics started getting tough from term two, because there was a lot of things like traveling salesman problem. It was really a optimization, those kind of things where the base was, some mathematical base, where let's say the economists were more around demand supply curves and, those kind of things. Mm. So they were not too much into econometrics and mathematics. So there are different things where both students can outshine each other. But I would say the most important thing is interest. And I think that is one failing I had in my MBA program, that really there were some subjects that I was very interested in. And I think there were a lot to do in HR and OB, very surprisingly, because I found a lot of these psychology and strategy courses very, very interesting. But some courses like, I don't want to mention, but let's say accounting, which I, you know, is learning. And that is something that I guess gets ingrained into you from a young age. So what you'll find is that the people who are learning continue to learn throughout. And the people who are basically trying to finish the program and get out into the real world are the ones who probably stop learning after maybe a year or two. And they are more interested in hanging out with friends. So I would say hanging out with friends is good, but you know, don't let that define or stop your learning in your career, because we are coming to a time where the cycles are becoming 10 years, everything is changing. Earlier it was 30 years. If you look at FMCG or brand, right? I mean, a Professor Anand Narasimha or, you know, Professor Bal Palekar, they can keep teaching their subjects for many, many years because the marketing or sales or brand has not changed in maybe, you know, 20, 30 years, because advertising itself hasn't.
Yeah.
But if you look at all these new age sciences like digital or analytics, if faculty don't, you know, change their kind of learning on those things to become current. So I know the question was on programming, right? So I would say the programming is also relevant to the faculty. If they continue teaching courses from a theoretical standpoint or, you know, equations and all that stuff, that will not do. Your course has to be skill-based, practical-oriented. You have to literally run the program like a SL class. And this is what even faculty at IIMs are doing now. They're moving away from the theoretical construct and they're trying to get more and more practical. I think because we have practitioner faculty, maybe we are a step ahead, but you know, every business school is moving that direction. So programming is actually very, very critical. I think if someone shies away from whatever be that programming, I mean, whether you're programming and you know, something which is menu driven, so you don't have to really know the commands and you're just dragging and placing commands from a menu, you know, or you are using platforms like Nine, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's the models are all inbuilt, but you have to create the input kind of, you know, the right configuration
customize,
of the model and customize the model and the right kind of thing, whatever be that framework. Or you are a expert Python programmer. Python, I think, is the language of the future. So whether it's Python or C, not C++, I would say C. Get those skills. Because now even querying, right? Earlier, people would get the IT guys to do SQL queries.
Mm.
Today, you don't have that flexibility because you don't have the IT guys. Okay. You are supposed to be an IT and business guy rolled in one.
Yes, sir.
Right? So the NoSQL querying languages, you know, database management, all the kind of commands around Python, data structures, pandas, you know, ingestion of data, that whole pandas thing, the matplotlib and pyplot, you know, plotting using pandas, whatever data you have. The entire Python framework should be something that most of our students should at least be having a 50% knowledge in. They should not believe we are business school students, so we should not do programming. And this is not related to only people who have analytics as minor or majors. It should be for all students, even marketing students who don't choose anything, any of these. So I think programming is very, very important. And this is one of the things I'm finding now in my startup, that if you are not able to understand some of the depths of programming, you are seen as the guy who brings the coffee for the rest of the team. and that is called business development.
Actually, one of my professors said that programming, what we hear about programming, it scares people.
Yeah.
Programming, basically, he told that it's a set of code to achieve common objective.
Yes.
Anything you enter, it will give that result. And if suppose we are adding any number you give, it will add. So logic is basically programming. Logic can be anything.
Yes.
So write pseudocode and convert it to a computer understandable language.
Python is really an open source. Like generally, people like my people I know are using old APIs from other apps and things.
Sure.
You know, build on then customize. As you pointed out, customizing the program according to your inputs.
No, API. You've heard of Postman, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they are all about API management.
Yeah.
Right. So who would have thought API management
yeah.
can be a business which is worth $3 to $4 billion, and that's what Postman is. if you go and talk to banks, right? And, you know, I was talking to the CFO. He said, why are you trying to sell me blockchain? Why don't you just fix my API banking? And he's nothing to do with IT or the kind of thing. He's CFO of the bank, right? And so what I'm saying is that the functionality. So it's not that you're trying to force fit a solution to a client. You are trying to understand what works easily, and if that benefits and creates a new business stream, or you know, makes things easier, or increases the potential customers that can come to you, everyone is interested.
We were talking about analytics, you know, changing the general traditional companies doing work. So this has actually brought about a lot of automation in traditional management roles. So how would you think that this is actually, to what extent do you think that it has eliminated traditional management roles, the automation of the process, people's work,
lower
basically
level jobs? How is it
like, even in financial services, like new age startups like Cred or these things, people are using robo advisors to advise their clients for a better financial advisory. So how much do you think extent is that?
So okay, so let me put it another way. Suppose you take index funds,
yeah,
right? These are basically funds which charge very low fees, asset management fees,
yeah,
and who are just tracking the index. Or you look at even, let's say, robo-advisors, right? So people basically use this as front ends to basically see what is the bare minimum. So like, let's say robo-advisor as a customer acquisition tool is more around just engaging with a customer to, let's say, share some details around, you know, what kind of policy he wants, etc., etc. But immediately what happens is, once a query gets complicated, it goes to the back end to a human, right? So maybe robo advisors will keep getting more and more you know, sophisticated, where they can translate a lot more logic, so they reduce the human component of the advice. But if you look at Indians, they prefer really something which they call specialist advice. So I don't mind paying 2.5% AMC fees for an actively managed fund,
yeah,
versus 1 or 1.5% fees for a exchange traded fund. Even though when I'm seeing that the stock market is going up by 20%, but my fund is going up by 10%. But still I'm saying I'm happy I'm in this fund because it has a good fund manager.
Yeah.
So that is showcasing the roles which are, let's say, the more, I would say, place where humans have skills, right? So the fund manager has obviously skills in actively choosing stocks. The person at the back end of the robo-advisor has, you know, all the set of understanding of what customers are really wanting when they're asking questions in a particular way. So they address that question, which a robo-advisor may not be able to understand,
yeah,
because it's worded in a different way. So the human brain and, you know, experience obviously cannot be substituted overnight. But to your question, you know, automation or robotic process automation, RPA, right, we call it, there's a course that you have in your curriculum, is supposed to replace 60 to 70% of what is called level one processes. Level one processes are, or level zero. Level zero is basically where there is no intelligence at all. It's just flow. Level one is that whether there's a clear cut logic where, you know, machine knows that, okay, A plus B equals C. So if A and B are, either of them are missing, I cannot go to C. So if there's some clear cut rules, that is level one, you need not use, you know, any human intervention. So the common logic is that 60 to 70% of those jobs which are level zero, level one will go off, but the high-end jobs, maybe it will be 20 or 30%. I would put it the other way, that the same point we were raising earlier about continuous learning. I would believe the people who are continuously learning will always continue to add value and be seen as a sense of people who are enriching the organization. And people who stop learning are basically seen as deadwood after a few years. So it might not impact you directly, but let's say after 5 years, and I've seen many of these examples, right? And it's not that those people have been sacked, but their roles have become, you know, pretty much that they're just going to work because they want that monthly salary at the end of the month. So after 5 years, when people stop learning, what is happening is that they get not so good projects. They, you know, essentially are, you know, not learning new stuff, so they are not interested in what they're doing. So it works both ways. So it becomes a vicious loop downwards. So I would say the automation works for even high-level employees with that orientation. And if you look at India, I think the automation level will increase for a lot of these global operations, because you know, a lot of those tasks, there's a lot of investment in technology and there's a lot of need for cost takeout.
Yeah.
But if you look at something which is servicing, let's say, domestic customers, you'll always need customer interfacing sort of, you know, customer service people, or you'll need people who are these fund managers or equity research broker analysts. And this cannot be automated like they have done in abroad. Abroad, you know, even research is automated, right? It's because they know that people are looking for certain things, certain ratios or certain ways kind of thing. But here people are looking at more of, how much do I glean from the back, right? So one is this research report, but if I talk to the analyst, I understand what is the true dynamics of this company. Or, you know, the very informal conversation, if you see how we try and specialize on people who make money, they essentially try to find out two levels deeper by engaging the equity research guy for things maybe he's not included in that report. So it's not about the form factor of the report or what is there, but can I interact with someone who knows the company? If I'm trying to invest in that company, right? So as an investor and so on. So India is a very different market where I think automation will not be as fast as we anticipate. Of course, for artistic roles, like, you know, when you look at, of course, professors, they believe it's going to all move online and all that stuff. I don't know, jury's out on that one. But artists, poets, painters, all these professions are supposed to have almost zero level of automation, right? Yeah. So I think it's you can build a case either way. Like if you look at Watson, which is IBM's AI engine, it's supposed to have created, you know, something like, prose like Shakespeare, or, you know, even poetry, right? And menus, right? But how effective these are, nobody knows. It's just like it's a talking point or it's an article in a, you know, global newspaper that, oh, you know, machine learning model did this. But how prevalent it'll be, you know, jury's out. Basically, no one knows.
They are able to create the rhyme like AABB, but...
Who?
That IBM.
Yeah.
Poetry, but that theme basically that poets create, that is missing.
But I'll tell you, it'll improve over generation. See, that's what is the evolution of machine learning, right? Initially, it was all junk, or it was, you know, some very basic things. But today, if you look at least in image recognition, CNN and, you know, those kind of, let's say, I mean, there are variants of the CNN, which are, you know, even able to detect depth. So if they see a photo, they know what is at the back and what is in the front. So for human, it seems natural. But for a machine to recognize that in a flat photograph, you know, for that depth of kind of thing, there's something called a six box some model, which is a ResNet model, right, for CNN. So what is happening is every generation of ML models are improving. So I don't see that it is because the technology is not good enough. It will be in future generations to, you know, over every, you know, 5 years, that the version changes or the... So I don't see that as a challenge as much as I see adoption, especially depending on the country. And probably the use case, right? So if it is not that poetry is what I want the ML engine to do, but, you know, for image recognition is where I want it to apply, then very few people will be actually using it for something like that.
Yes, sir.
But if enough people were to actually do that, I'm sure the technology would be good enough that, you know, next generation, you would not be able to differentiate. That's the Turing test, by the way.
Yes.
The Turing test that, you know, you don't differentiate between machine and human. And that was happened for the first time for Google when someone called up a pizza shop and a machine answered. And the human did not make out that it was a machine who was saying, okay, sir, what pizza do you want? So he said, some pepperoni and cheese. Okay, one pepperoni and cheese to be delivered to you, this. So the computer had all these speech to text, text to speech, all that stuff.
Sophia robot?
No, that's the first citizen of Dubai or UAE. But this was like a engine which was able to decipher speech, then it did all the analytics, and was the machine out was again translated into speech. So text to speech and speech to text. So that is common technology now. But that whole process of being able to, for the human not to recognize that, and it's happening today where we have passed the Turing test, I have no doubt that if Google and companies like that were to progress on those lines, that they would be able to create something, because you have the biggest brains working for them. And I also want students today to actually look at their career not like a, you know, standalone MBA, marketing, finance, etc. See, one of the good things in the school is you have a lot of startups coming here, and I'm just, because I'm a startup guy, doesn't mean, I'm talking of more developed startups, like, you know, guys like Paytm, PhonePe, you know, these kind of startups who have reached that stage of maturity, who have a lot of challenges as they are scaling up in the market. So to develop new use cases, to do that kind of thing. So if our students are able to kind of get into those kind of roles, it was like my entrepreneurship, that you're creating something. And, you know, I mean, all my friends were asking me, why are you working in this Indian manufacturing Lala company? And I said, look, I've never been so happy in my life versus working in all the MNCs of the world, right? And so I would say that to each his own, but there is a lot of this kind of roles which are opening up. And, you know, if we just remove that tag of high salary for, you know, how we compare and how people respect us, or that tag of that company, and you can get beyond that. There's a guy called Mukunda. I don't know whether you know Mukunda from the batch senior. Okay, he's working for a municipal department, BMC, for creating a blockchain for being able to track waste. And he's a, you know, a good friend of mine, so he keeps dropping in to meet me sometimes. So he's someone who understood coding. He was interested in blockchain. And he's solving a municipality problem where he's probably getting paid peanuts. And there are huge challenges because technology adoption, you know, in a government department, you know, everyone will be saying, please, you know, don't automate anything, don't kind of thing. So there's a lot of opposition he's facing as well. But how happy he is to be able to do something like that versus someone who's joined XYZ company at the highest internship salary with a full placement, a final placement guaranteed offer. I would say, you know, I would move away from that mindset. And I would say that, okay, look, what are you learning on the internship? What are you learning in the final placement? And where you on this path of continuous learning? Again, to each his own. But I mean, to me, I find that has given me the greatest satisfaction, where I'm able to kind of, the guy who replaced me in Merrill today is probably 30 times my net worth, 30 times. And he's the head of investment banking, right? So his name is Raj Balakrishnan, right? He's the head of investment banking for Merrill Lynch today. He's the guy who replaced me. So when I moved out of Merrill, he came into my role. Now I can look back and say that, oh, you know, I could have been head of investment banking in Merrill Lynch, right? And obviously this guy is getting, you know, salary which is like probably, you know, top 0.001% in India, right? So, but he's a very down-to-earth guy, and, you know, we are in touch. He's now doing running marathons and all that stuff. But all I'm just saying is that it's really your call that, you know, I mean, are you really happy with what you're doing, or are you feeling that you're satisfying outside people who are looking at you and saying, oh, wow, you know, we wish we were there. I think that when you go into the mind of that person, you find out, and maybe he's perfectly happy where he is. I'm not trying to second guess that, but I'm just saying that, like, what I've found is that that's very shallow. Like, you know, when you are stuck in some place where, you know, it's just a good, nice sounding job, and, you know, obviously pay is very important. I'm not downplaying pay, and that's why you are doing an MBA program. You should be at the cutting edge of pay. But pay should not be the only reason or the primary reason why you are in something.
So talking about startups, so currently the startups are mostly based on technology.
Yeah.
Most of the startups. And our recruiters, especially MBA recruiters, traditional companies like consulting companies, like what?
KPMG.
KPMG, yeah. Big Four or MBB. So how us as an MBA will be able to fit in the core technology roles?
in the new age startup, unicorns that are constantly
and
coming
we
out.
We also know that fintech is rising with 22% per year, CGR.
So, see, I'll tell you, the way the fintechs look at MBAs is that MBAs are good at presentation skills and good with PowerPoint. So we will fit them into a business development role. So if you look at your previous batch and maybe the batch before, most of the people who have joined startups have been in a BD role, business development. And I have nothing against BD because I myself was the head of BD for IBM. Okay, so inorganic business development was M&A, it was called business development or corporate development, right? So basically you're doing the inorganic growth of the company. So I have nothing against BD, but I would say in IBM, we were the guys who were trying to do all kinds of partnerships, right, with, you know, software companies or something which was basically helping IBM sell more rather than looking at its sales. But what I found was that was a function which was slightly defunct because IBM did most of its M&A in US and maybe Western Europe. So I basically got very bored of my job. And I said, I need to be in the forefront of what IBM is doing. And for that, it was sales. And again, I always have this tendency to move from staff role to line role, which is what I did from, you know, my M&A role in Sonacoyo to entrepreneur business leadership role in for a supply chain within the organization. So in IBM also 5 years I did as an M&A guy. And 5 years I actually got a chance to move into a sales role, although they typically don't take guys from a finance background. So it's really up to you. And my boss probably thought I was going to quit if I didn't, you know, move into that, you know, specific role. So he basically became the head of the business and then he sort of got me into this large deal sales leader role. So in that sales role, what I found was that it was immensely powerful. So I was actually able to crack 3 of the biggest deals for IBM with Adani Group, which was a $50 million deal, you know, over 9 years. Then we did a deal with Birla Sun Life, again, one of the biggest deals that year. So I got very successful in my sales role in IBM, but what I found was that it was a very mundane job from the perspective that you do the same thing day in and day out. And in my personality, that was something that I was not really cut out for. I'm always trying to learn new things. And the sales role didn't give me that. So coming back to the question, right? So fintech, what my aim for fintech students is that can they go into product manager roles? So product manager roles means that they don't need to be deep technical guys.
Yeah.
But they're guys who understand reasonably like APIs, you know, what APIs do,
yeah,
right? It's not that they need to know, you know, microservices programming using, you know, whatever, you know, all the object-oriented structures. So you don't need to kind of go, you know, 10 levels deeper into APIs, but, you know, at least you must know what are the building blocks,
yeah,
so that you can define that for the architects who will actually work on it,
mm,
or the technical guys, right? So if I can create a set of people who are product managers, and product managers are different from project managers.
Mm.
Project managers manage people, and it's like a large project services,
yeah,
thing. That's a very, I would say, a very boring job. Because I mean, I've been IBM, and you know, it's like managing problems. Like, so some person will have some problem because he has some family issue. Some person is quitting. Some person is doing this. You're going and managing some HR kind of job, right? Which is project management. Product management is about how do you actually create the next product that will make or break the company. So this is clearly central. This is something that marries and requires both your MBA strategy kind of knowledge, your knowledge of the financial markets and, you know, what products can fly, as well as this whole thing about understanding technology as blocks,
hmm,
not, you know, deeper, and it can apply to BBAs and BCOMs, you know. So if you look at the best business schools like ISB and all that stuff, right, they are producing their MBAs to be product managers in fintechs. So I want us to kind of move from being BD guys. And there's nothing wrong with BD guys per se, but I'm saying if you want to be at the center, you should be in a line function, and you should be someone who's basically controlling everything. And that happened to me in my sales role, because I was running a team of 30 people, because these were large deals. So you would have legal guy, pricing guy, the technical guy, the architect, the junior sales guys. So all of them typically reporting to you in a matrix structure. You are not their formal bosses, but you are the lead for a deal. which is a large deal, right? I was a large deals guy, right? So all these guys in Matrix were reporting into you, and you were the center of the organization. And that's how that role is different from being a M&A guy who is basically trying to do, you know, all this kind of jugglery with numbers and proposals which go nowhere, because IBM does not want to do anything in India. I mean, I had so many debates with various people as to, you know, I mean, why do you even have a team in India, right? So kind of stuff. And today, I mean, after, like, I've moved on, I think now the team from six people have become a one-man organization, because it just needs to be staffed by one guy. So I'm saying, from being at the periphery of the organization to being at the center of the organization should be the goal of every MBA. And that's what I have personally tried to do in my life. And that's why I'm so excited with what I do, because, you know, I mean, when I'm talking to you, you'd realize that, you know, some part of it is all based on experience. I'm not read some, you know, 2-3 textbooks, yeah, and I'm trying to kind of throw some jargon around, right? So that is where I would say that, you know, leverage this factor from each of your faculty, so that when you go on to the job, you are, you know, basically aware of a lot of things. And the MBA is generalist skills, where you are expert in HR, strategy, finance, and marketing. And the biggest mistake I made in my MBA program was treating finance as my major and marketing as something I didn't need to know. And I had 5 years as a hardcore sales guy. And one of the things I even find here, when you look at managing an RI project, is marketing research was something which is so important. And I keep telling that to students, right? So take the set of courses as a set of amalgams. If you can take 129 credits and you can manage, do that, you know, instead of 109 credits, you know, which is one end of the scale versus this. But ensure that you give enough time and you are passing those courses, right? You don't want to stay back an extra year because you have taken extra credits you can't manage. But if you are feeling confident, take more and more subjects which are across the disciplines, so that, you know, at least you have a base knowledge in each area. Because suddenly, suppose you join Tata's, and they put you into Jamshedpur to manage some union which is kind of this, and yeah, you say, oh, actually I'm a marketing guy and I got into this Tata administrative services role, I don't know what to do. They will tell you, you're a general manager. General manager means whether you are the CEO of one of the Tata group companies, or you are put into HR role, or you're put into a marketing role, or whatever, you have to have that base knowledge to be able to do that. Otherwise, you know, you should not have been selected at all.
The thing that you pointed out, that students, you know, you aim to that we students in the future become product managers in startups. So I believe that me and Santu over here actually got into MBA thinking of finance and, you know, connecting it with analytics. We thought, I personally also imagine myself working in startup or any place, but as a product manager for a new sort of, you know, product, like even in a P2P lending or even an agri-tech thing. So that is one thing I think that we were actually connected to. That is what
Great.
We actually also
Great.
Aim.
Great.
Planning to start.
Yeah.
Business in agri-tech only.
Right. And that's big, right? It's one of the top segments now for application of
yeah.
analytics in across Indian
that's
industry.
That's a sector which is not even remotely touched with technology.
No, no, you're wrong.
No,
Sant.
It is.
Ninja
Cart is making a big stride.
No,
this
Ninja
space.
Cart is, of course, you know,
yeah.
this farm to fork kind of thing. But
yeah.
actually, if you look at now, the current state, you'll find that almost 40% of ML startups are in agri space.
Hmm.
Because everyone has realized exactly that thing, that, you know, it was earlier untouched. So now, whether it is IBM's weather company, which is trying to give, you know, rainfall and, you know, predictions for one day, or, you know, 1 week forward to a farmer, to advise to what crops to buy, you know, this ITC eChopal, right? So there are big corporates who are also now coming into the segment,
yeah.
let alone agri startups. So you're in a very crowded space. And I was actually in touch with some people in IIM Bangalore. They are trying to do a blockchain for agri. So the students have done all the code and everything, and they are trying to actually create this blockchain that can apply so that, you know, the food traceability, it's called provenance, can be assured for the agri food chain. In fact, we are, Dr. Kamalika and I are giving a RI project in this area for 2022 batch. So if you guys are interested, you all should, you know, probably consider that as one of the projects you all can do. So where we are trying to actually try and understand this blockchain provenance for a food chain. Now, I mean, since India is the second or third largest from an agricultural standpoint, and there'll be things like milk and dairy products where India is probably the second largest and all.
Dairy.
Yeah. So it's a big segment. it is highly suboptimal, and it needs these analytics kind of solutions to go in there. And the market is huge. It's not that, you know, if there are 20 players in there, the market is saturated. Everyone has their share of business. But the issue is that that is...
It isn't along with the business of the India.
No, no. But if you look at US, right? US says you are not opening financial services. But have they opened their own agri market to India?
Yeah.
Forget food. Just look at even their base agriculture. Every country is protective in their own way. But they will throw treaties at you saying that, you know, India is non-compliant and all that stuff. But if we don't protect our own industry and business, you know, we are in a spot of trouble. And, you know, someone was giving me a very interesting statistics. I don't know who it was. They said this whole import duty imposition of 7.5% on stainless steel actually allowed the domestic steel manufacturers to survive. And once that moved to zero because of this Asian free trade agreements and all that stuff, these guys were dead because, you know, the cost of importing with the import duty, etc., and then doing the processing and final finishing, whatever, you know, the HRC, cold roll, whatever, you know, the flat and steel, flat and whatever, longs. That whole process to manufacture in India subscale, you'd never be able to produce at the scale of a Korea or Japan, right? And China, of course, for whatever they're dumping, right? So that 7.5% duty actually protected so many manufacturers here. So the same way in agricultural manufactured goods or other things where, or you know, where you can, let's say, give that option to a farmer to export is good, so that, you know, he's protected if the domestic market dries up and there's no MSP kind of issue, and that's a very controversial issue. But if food grains or FCI does not procure enough food grains, then you should have an alternate market to sell to. Which is what the government is saying. And everyone, we are so used to subsidy and those kind of things that we are not able to embrace the new.
I think that's the pretty much really insights, sir, from MBAs to life to future progression. Sir has covered every aspect in this talk show. I think, I suppose, son, we had not imagined that this session would be so fruitful to
us.
Sir,
actually. We didn't plan for this kind of thing, but it went on
pretty well, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was really lovely to interact with you, and
I hope some more sessions in future with you.
Yeah, thank you for having me, and maybe you'll find that the next session I will tell you exactly the same things in different ways. So I don't have so many things to talk, but the good thing is that since I've worked for 8 very different kind of organizations, I think my exposure across sectors is something which is helpful to students who are having very different goals in their mind. So I can mentor students from very different areas, and of course mentor can also mean reverse mentor, like don't do what I did. Right, so both apply, right?
Yes sir,
actually we learn from you. That's
thank you
sir. Thank you, sir.